Hello and welcome back. Today I am going to speak about MRI in sports related muscle injuries. Muscle injuries represent a major challenge for professional athletes. The main goal of sports physician is to return an athlete to competition. Prognosis is based on the available clinical and imaging information. Imaging is crucial to confirm and assess the extent of injuries, for which ultrasonography and MRI are commonly used modalities. The mechanism of injury. It can be a direct or an indirect trauma. An indirect trauma is usually strain related and more commonly seen. Direct trauma can be a blunt or penetrating injury. Role of MRI provides an excellent soft tissue contrast and multiplanar assessment. It is used to confirm and assess the extent and severity of muscle injuries, and it is better than ultrasound in detecting deeper compartmental muscle injuries. MRI is usually performed unilaterally of the affected limb using a dedicated surface coil. The contralateral limb can be screened using a higher FOV, especially when bilateral injury is suspected. And a skin marker, whenever available, should always be placed over the area of maximum symptoms. Fluid sensitive sequences like fat suppressed T2-weighted images, proton density images, and STIR images are extremely useful for the evaluation of muscle injuries. T1-weighted images are less sensitive, however, they are useful in the assessment of hematomas and to detect extent of atrophy and fatty infiltration of muscles. Muscle injuries are graded into grade 1, grade 2 and grade 3 injuries depending on the severity. Most of the muscle injuries occur around the myotendinous junction, and this is seen as diffuse abnormal area of high signal intensity around the myotendinous junction, giving a classical feathery appearance. Grade 1 injuries is presence of diffuse muscle edema without obvious disruption of the muscle fibers. The tendon at the myotendinous junction appears normal or mildly thickened. There can be mild degree of perifacial fluid, and clinically there is no loss or just mild loss of the muscular function. This is a grade 1 injury of the semimembranosus muscle. There is diffuse muscle edema giving a feathery appearance. The tendon at the myotendinous junction appears continuous of normal caliber and shows uniformly low signal intensity. There is mild degree of perifacial edema. No obvious discontinuity or disruption of the muscle fibers is visible. Grade 2 injuries. Grade 2 injuries will have features of grade 1 injury, and in addition to that, there will be partial disruption of the muscle fibers with hematoma formation. The tendon at the myotendinous junction may be thickened and may exhibit features of laxity or partial disruption. There will be moderate to severe perifacial fluid, and clinically, there will be moderate loss of the muscular function. This is an example of grade 2 injury involving the semimembranosus muscle. A focal area of high signal intensity is seen within the muscle fibers of semimembranosus, representing partial disruption of its fibers. The tendon at the myotendinous junction appears normal. Diffuse muscle edema is noted, and there is mild degree of perifacial fluid. Grade 3 injuries represent complete disruption of the myotendinous junction with local hematoma formation, or there can be complete avulsion of muscles from their bony attachment sites. Let us see an example of grade 3 avulsion injury at the ischial tuberosity. For that, let us first revise the normal anatomy in this region. The ischial tuberosity gives origin to the hamstring group of muscles. Posteriorly, this is the common origin of biceps femoris and semitendinosus. Anteriorly, this is the origin of semimembranosus. Lateral to these is the sciatic nerve, which is labeled with a yellow circle. Injury to the sciatic nerve is common in avulsion injuries of at the ischial tuberosity. In this case, the common origin of the hamstring group of muscles is not visualized at this ischial tuberosity, and there is mild fluid over here. The coronal images in the same patient show torn and retracted proximal myotendinous junctions, and there is a large hematoma filling the gap between the torn ends. This is a grade 3 avulsion injury. Again, a grade 3 injury. The tendon at the myotendinous junction shows abnormal signal hyperintensity as compared to this adjoining tendon, which appears uniformly black. Surrounding mild muscle edema is seen with mild degree of perifacial fluid. On coronal images in the same patient, we see the tendon which appearing normal proximally. However, distally, there is complete discontinuity of the tendon here. This is the proximal torn end. This is the distal torn end. Surrounding muscle edema, this is a grade 3 injury at the myotendinous junction. Delayed onset muscle soreness or DOMS. It is commonly seen in athletes and typically presents with muscle tightness, pain and tenderness 24 to 72 hours after the exercise and usually resolves within a week's time. This patient had undergone a 7 km dream run at the Mumbai Marathon. 3 days later, he presented with calf pain. There was diffuse edema in the medial and lateral heads of the gastrocnemius. This was a military recruit who had undergone heavy weightlifting 2 days back and presented with upper limb pain. The imaging showed diffusely bulky and edematous brachialis muscle. In both the cases, there was no specific history of any trauma or strain injury. Both the patients had undergone rigorous strenuous exercise. These are typical cases of delayed onset muscle soreness. Medial tibial stress syndrome. It is also known as shin splints. It is a clinical syndrome of calf pain during activity with tenderness along a specific length of posteromedial tibia. Primarily occurs in runners and military recruits, and it is thought to be due to traction over the tibial periosteum secondary to repetitive contraction of the soleus muscle. Radiographs and CT are usually normal and are done to rule out an underlying stress fracture. The most common MRI abnormality in patients with shin splints is a thin layer of fluid along the outer aspect of posteromedial tibial cortex. Some affected tibia may also demonstrate peripheral bone marrow edema along the endosteal surface of posteromedial tibia. A pain marker was kept. Mild degree of fluid is seen along the posteromedial aspect of tibia. Also, there was mild bone marrow edema along the endosteal surface of tibia along the posteromedial aspect. No obvious intracortical fracture line is identified, and therefore this is the case of shin splints or medial tibial stress syndrome. Stress fractures. 1/4 to 1/2 of all sports related stress fractures occur in tibia. Incomplete transverse fractures happen along the anterior and posterior tibial cortices. Radiographs may show an intracortical fracture line, or sometimes there would be just mild focal periosteal reaction representing immature callus in a case of healing stress fracture, and that may be the only abnormality visible on the radiographs. This radiograph shows an intramedullary nail with an incomplete transverse fracture line along the anterior tibial cortex, an example of stress fracture. On MRI, the key finding is a fracture line involving one of the cortices. There can be also focal endosteal or periosteal callus formation seen, which appears calcified on CT and of low signal intensity on MRI. Adjacent edema in the bone marrow and soft tissues is extensive. It is usually more extensive than a tibial shin splint injury. These are few examples of stress fractures. Linear fracture lines are seen involving the anterior cortex of tibia with extensive bone marrow edema and adjacent soft tissue edema. The image on the right also shows an incomplete transverse fracture line involving the posterior cortex of tibia with mild adjacent soft tissue edema. Now let us see the difference between a shin splint injury and stress fracture. No obvious intracortical fracture line is seen in shin splint injury, whereas a fracture line will be visible in a stress fracture. The bone marrow edema is usually extensive in a stress fracture and involves almost the entire cross-sectional area of the bone. Whereas in shin splint injury, the bone marrow edema is focal along the endosteal surface. The soft tissue edema is also more extensive in a stress fracture as compared to a shin splint injury. Is imaging required before return to play? One must always remember that functional recovery precedes structural recovery seen at imaging. And therefore, imaging is usually not required before an athlete returns to play. Radiology plays an increasingly important role in the initial assessment and follow-up of muscle injuries. And the most common mechanism of injury of muscles in athletes is an indirect trauma, that is, it is strain related. Thank you.